We've seen a lot of nucleophilic addition reactions to aldehydes and ketones, and in this video we're going to look at the addition of carbon nucleophiles. So if I started with an aldehyde or ketone and I add something like potassium cyanide and a source of protons, I'm going to form a cyanohydrin over here. And so this is a cyano group, and notice we're forming a carbon-carbon bond, so that can be useful for synthesis reactions. So let's look in more detail at our carbon nucleophile, which is this from the cyanide anion here. So let's go ahead and draw the cyanide anion. So that would be carbon triple bonded to nitrogen. I have the lone pair of electrons on this carbon like that. And so that gives this carbon a negative one formal charge, which makes it a nucleophile. It's attracted to positively charged things. And over here on our carbonyl, right, we know our oxygen is partially negative, and we know our carbonyl carbon is partially positive. And so the carbonyl carbon is our electrophile. And so our nucleophile is going to attack our electrophile. So these opposite charges attract here, and these electrons are going to attack right here at this carbon, pushing these electrons off onto the oxygen. So let's draw the intermediate. We would now form a carbon-carbon bond, and then this carbon is triple bonded to a nitrogen like that. So following our electrons, right, these electrons right here are forming this carbon-carbon bond. And then on the left side, we would have our oxygen, this time with three lone pairs of electrons on it, which gives it a negative one formal charge. And if we started with an aldehyde, we would have an R and an H here. And so in the final step, all we have to do is protonate our oxygen. So a lone pair of electrons picks up this proton, right, to form this OH, and we formed our cyanohydrin as our product. Let's look at an example of cyanohydrin formation. If we started with something like acetone, so a ketone, and we added potassium cyanide and hydrochloric acid, right, we would form our cyanohydrins. So we would have our carbon triple bonded to our nitrogen over here, and then we would have our OH over here. And since we started with a ketone this time, we would have these two methyl groups right here like that. And so once you form a cyano group here, you can convert this into other functional groups. So that's another reason why it is useful for a synthesis. All right, let's look at another reaction where we have a carbon nucleophile, and these would be the organometallics. And specifically, we have a Grignard reagent here. So we have an alkyl group, right, bonded to magnesium, and then a halogen, so an organomagnesium compound. We could have just as easily done something like R prime and then a bond to lithium, so an organolithium compound. So these are just organometallics. Now, the thing about organometallics is the electronegativity difference between the carbon that's bonded in this case to the magnesium, or the carbon bonded to lithium. Right, carbon is more electronegative than those atoms. And so if you think about the bond, let me go ahead and highlight it here, right? This bond between the carbon and our magnesium, carbon's more electronegative, so those electrons are polarized, right, towards the carbon. And so you could think about these bonds as being very polar covalent bonds, or you could even think about those electrons in blue being on your carbon. So let's go ahead and draw it that way. So another way to think about it would be it's so polarized that those electrons are on your carbon, which gives you a negative one formal charge, and you form a carb anion. So either way of thinking about it is fine with me. Maybe some professors might care. But once you think about it as being a carb anion, it makes these reactions a little bit easier because, once again, you have a polarized carbonyl situation, partial negative, partial positive, and so your nucleophile can attack right here, pushing these electrons off onto your oxygen. And so you could have just as easily thought about it this way, right, with a very polar covalent bond right here and attacking here. Or you could think about it as being ionic, right, with these electrons on the carbon forming a carb anion. So you'll see either mechanism depending on which textbook that you look in. And so once the nucleophile attacks, right, we would now have a carbon bonded to our R double prime group. And then over here on the left, we would have our negatively charged oxygen like that. So an R group and then a hydrogen if we started with an aldehyde. And so let's those electrons in blue, well, let's go ahead and change them, make them red here. So these electrons are right here, right? So those are these electrons, right? That formed this bond. So we formed a carbon-carbon bond now. And then in the next step of the mechanism, which needs to be kept separate, we're going to add a proton source or something like water. And so once again, we're going to protonate our alk oxide intermediate. So we pick up a proton here, and then that gives us our final product, which is an alcohol. And we can see we've added on our R double prime group and formed a carbon-carbon bond. So once again, a very useful reaction for synthesis. Now, you have to do this reaction in two steps, because if you try to do it in one step, if you tried to add on the proton at the same time you added your organometallic, right, these are good nucleophiles. They're also strong bases. And so if you think about a carb anion here reacting with water, it's just going to pick up the proton from water to form an alkane, right? So it's just going to go like that and form an alkane. And so you don't want that to happen, which is why you need to separate these steps. And this is an oversimplified mechanism of what's happening, but it's just the best way to think about it for an undergraduate student. Let's look at some examples of a organometallic reaction here. So this time we're starting with an aldehyde, and we have methyl magnesium bromide here in our first step. In a second step, we need to add a proton source. And so once again, you could think about the bond between the carbon and the magnesium as being very polar covalent, or you could think about that bond as being ionic, right? And those two electrons in magenta on the carbon to form your carb anion. So like this, so a negative one formal charge in that carbon. And so that's just a simple way of thinking about it here for trying to figure out the product, right? So you would attack right here and push these electrons off onto your oxygen. Right, so if we showed the intermediate, right, we would have our carbon right here is now bonded to a methyl group, still have a hydrogen, right, and then we would have an alk oxide anion as our intermediate, like that, so negative one formal charge. And so the bond that's formed, right, is between this carbon and this carbon, like that. And in the second step, we would protonate our alk oxide to form our alcohol. So I'm going to go ahead and draw out our alcohol here. So we would have an OH. And then you can see that we have increased the number of carbons, right? If we look at how many carbons that we started with, we had 1, 2, 3, 4 carbons. So we started with butanol. And then when we are done, we ended with, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbons. So we finished with 2 pentanol and we added 1 carbon on, right? So this methyl group is the one that we added on in our organometallic reaction for our Grignard reagent. So this is what we started with. So notice when you start with an aldehyde, let me just change colors again. When you start with an aldehyde, you're going to end up with a secondary alcohol, right? So this carbon that's bonded to your OH is bonded to 2 other carbons. So an aldehyde goes to a secondary alcohol. Let's look at one more example. So this time we're going to start with a ketone, all right? So same reagent, but this time we're starting with a ketone. And so once again, thinking about what happens, right? So this time I could just show these electrons right here, right, attacking this carbon, right, pushing these electrons off onto the oxygen. And then in the second step, we know that we would protonate the alk oxide anion. And so we can just go ahead and draw the final product. We'd have our ring, right, and we're adding on, and again, a methyl group. So let me go ahead and put a CH3 right here. And then, of course, we would form an OH like that. So let's, again, think about electrons. So these electrons right here, right, formed this bond, and then we just added on CH3 too. So that's one way to think about how to draw your final products. And so this time, if you think about our starting material, we started with a ketone, right, and then we finished with a tertiary alcohol. So if I look at this carbon, the one that's bonded to the OH right here, this carbon is bonded to 1, 2, 3 other carbons. So this is how to make one way to make a tertiary alcohol.